Welcome to the kind of first of the panel sessions for this Black Jacobins Revisited conference. And I'm very pleased to welcome Raphael Hoermann and Joanna Tegnerowicz. And they're speaking on this panel, which is, I guess, of kind of great interest in terms of the text, in terms of James rewriting Marx, and how we're going to work it is that Raphael and Joanna are going to speak, and then we'll have questions at the end. So I'd first like to introduce Raphael Hoermann. He's going to speak about the 18th Brumaire of Toussaint Louverture, C.L.R. James's Poetics of Anti-Colonial Revolution in the Black Jacobins, and Marx's 18th Brumaire.
This paper wants to illustrate the importance of Marx's essay, The 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, 1852, for James, the Black Jacobins, and trace their poetics of revolution. By poetics of revolution, I understand the casting of theoretical or historical observations on revolution into literary analogies or metaphors. In the Black Jacobins, Marx's Brumaire is clearly marked as an important point of reference. For instance, James quotes a long passage from the Brumaire in which Marx first introduces the Bayes superstructure analogy. While I do not have time here to consider James' use of this analogy, it is crucial to keep in mind that James adds race into the equation, an element that Marx ignores due to his Eurocentric perspective with its sole focus on class. The same difference also applies to their respective poetics. Now I'm coming first to the Brumaire. The revolutionary drama in the 18th Brumaire. In a highly satirical vein, in the 18th Brumaire, Marx analyzes the failed revolution of 1848 in France and its aftermath. Its scope reaches from the overthrow of the parliamentary monarchy of Louis-Philippe in February 1848 to Louis Bonaparte's coup d'état in December 1851. Marx's analysis of Louis Bonaparte's, that he was Napoleon's nephew, rise to power from penniless exile, actually Britain, to dictator and then emperor of France, has been hailed as a groundbreaking investigation into a totalitarian takeover, an aspect that James engages with in his 1966 lecture, Marx's 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte and the Caribbean. It's in this recent collection, You Don't Play With Revolution, by Bill, who has given a keynote this morning. For the Black Jacobins, I want to argue, however, another aspect of the Brumaire is more important, significant. It's poetics of revolution. A tension between two dramatic genres, tragedy and farce, structures Marx's satirical essay. In his reckoning with the failed 1848 revolution and his analysis of Louis Bonaparte's subsequent rise to power, Marx draws up a sophisticated and sustained poetics of revolution. The French Revolution and Napoleon's counter-revolutionary coup of the 18th Brumaire, which effectively ended the French Revolution, are cast as great tragedy. By contrast, their repetitions, the bourgeois revolutions of 1848 and Louis Bonaparte's counter-revolutionary coup on the 2nd of December 1851, which ended the short-lived Second French Republic, are cast as a shabby farce. The heroes of the First French Revolution, Robespierre, Danton, Napoleon, contrast sharply with the pathetic anti-heroes of the 1848 revolutionary and counter-revolutionary drama, among them Louis Bonaparte. Don't have time to go into this tension now, and it's not really that relevant to the Black Jacobins, but there's more to be said, obviously. Besides great tragedy and squalid farce, Marx introduces another genre of revolutionary drama, which I have termed proletarian tragedy. Marx associates it with the massive workers' revolt in Paris in June 1848. In an editorial written immediately after this revolt, Marx regards it as the second act of the French Revolution, which is only the beginning of the European tragedy. So it's already clearly marked as a tragedy. What was this revolt? A very brief history. on the 23rd of June 1848, when the revolutionary government announced the closure of the national workshops, which were created to combat widespread unemployment, the workers rose in protest, building barricades. The National Guard confronted them, and this standoff turned into a series of the deadliest street battles of the 19th century that lasted for 3 days. Scholars estimate that casualties among the workers amounted to 2,000 dead and at least 1,000 wounded, with 11,000 arrested. Marx, here we see some images here of the street fighting. This is a very interesting image, one of the first photograph of barricade, and due to the long exposure, you can't see the attackers, only the ones manning the barricade. So Marx's verdict in the Brumaire that the June insurrection marked the most colossal event in the history of the European civil wars is not merely motivated by the staggering number of casualties, but even more by the revolt's ideological significance. Marx, alongside many other contemporaries from all political factions, identified the June insurrection as the most significant instance of class struggle to date. For Marx, the workers marked the revolutionary vanguard, proletarian revolutionaries that fought for a social revolution. Here we see one instance. We see a slogan, du pain ou la mort. So no longer liberty or death, but bread or death. They marked the revolutionary vanguard, proletarian revolutionaries that fought for a social revolution. They took the slogans of the old French Revolution and filled them with a new social revolutionary content. When the workers proclaimed the Social Republic during the June Revolution, the general content of the modern revolution was being signaled, Marx insists. It includes the demand that rather being limited to political rights for the bourgeoisie, liberty, equality, and fraternity, in the proletarian sense, must apply to the workers and include socio-economic rights too. By contrast, the bourgeoisie in the 1848 revolution merely anachronistically resurrected the specter of the old revolution and reiterated its slogans as mere phrases. As Marx insists, in proletarian revolutions, contents transcend phrase, while in bourgeois revolution, phrase transcended contents. By extending the meaning of the rights of man in a social sense, the June insurrection forms part of the dramatic prologues of proletarian revolution, which aims for the complete emancipation of the proletariat. The June insurrection marks for Marx as first step in the gradual process of proletarian revolution, characterized by perpetual self-criticism and constant setbacks. It will eventually reach an anti-tragic revolution when circumstances themselves cry out. However, for the time being, this remains still a long way off. In the 1848 revolution, the proletariat still constitutes a tragic hero who, after its dramatic appearance during the June insurrection, moves into the background of the revolutionary stage. However, in contrast to the bourgeois actors, whose defeat at the hands of Louis Bonaparte was pathetic, the Parisian proletariat forms a genuine tragic hero. It was defeated with the honors of a great world historical struggle. Okay, now I'm moving on to James. First of all, proletarian anti-tragedy in the Haitian Revolution. While farce is largely absent from the Black Jacobins, revolutionary tragedy is not. There has been much attention paid to Toussaint's tragedy as the tragic revolutionary leader, yet very little to the tragedy of the revolutionary masses. By contrast, I want to focus on the revolutionary masses and on anti-tragic and tragic elements in their revolutionary drama. James regards the Haitian Revolution not merely as a slave and anti-colonial revolution, but also a proto-proletarian one. As he insists, the slaves working in the sugar factories were closer to a modern proletariat than any group of workers in existence at the time, and the Rising was therefore a thoroughly prepared and organized mass movement. As proto-proletarians, the Haitian slave revolutionaries achieved a similar task as their European counterparts of appropriating the rights of men of the French Revolution for their own purposes and extending their meaning. This is quite a famous quote. Meanwhile, of the slaves, they heard of the revolution and had construed it in their own image. The white slaves in France had risen and killed their masters and were now enjoying the fruits of the earth. It was gravely inaccurate, in fact, but they had caught the spirit of the thing: liberty, equality, fraternity. When the slaves appropriate the rights of men, they radically extend their social and racial meaning. While these rights were only supposed to apply to the white male bourgeois citizen, the slaves claimed them for themselves as Afro-Caribbean proto-proletarians. James Black Jacobins anticipate the actions of Marx Parisian proletarians by endowing the rights of men with a new social content. However, there remains a key difference. Marx is not at all concerned with the race limitations, merely with the class limitations to the rights of men, because neither Marx nor James are concerned with the gender limitations, but that's a different issue. By contrast, James emphasizes that the Black Jacobins not only aim for a social revolution that would redistribute property, enjoying the fruits of the earth, but also one in which they, as black ex-slaves, would be equal to the self-liberated white slaves. A further aspect also sets them apart from Marx's proletarians. At least at first glance, it seems as if the plot of the Haitian Revolution and Black Jacobins is decidedly anti-tragic. The self-liberation of the proto-proletarian slaves, the victory over the contemporary European colonial superpowers, France, Britain, and Spain, and independence from France in the end, form part of an epic narrative of revolutionary success. This allows James to praise the Haitian Revolution as one of the greatest epics of revolutionary struggle and achievement. I will debate later whether the ending of this epic really provides an entirely anti-tragic resolution for the ex-slaves. Now coming to the tragedy of Toussaint Louverture. By contrast, Toussaint Louverture is very explicitly cast as a tragic hero, the very opposite of the farcical Louis Bonaparte in Marx's Brumaire. For David Scott, Toussaint's tragedy even epitomizes that of the anti-colonial revolutionary and intellectual. Kara M. Rabbit identifies him as a classic Aristotelian hero. His tragic flaw in his character consists in his hubris towards his people, which led to a fatal neglect of his people, who were his power base. James is slightly more ambivalent about Toussaint's tragic status when he points out that the defeat of Toussaint in the War of Independence and his imprisonment and death in Europe are universally looked upon as a tragedy. Toussaint is further compared to Greek and Shakespearean tragic heroes such as Lear and Hamlet. For example, he now resembles Hamlet in his indecisiveness, his tergiversations, basically his inability to move, decide, his inability to take firm and realistic decisions. In an instance of deep dramatic irony, we watch Toussaint, alias Hamlet, make his blunders and stumble towards his inevitable catastrophe. However, James relativizes the status of Toussaint as a classic hero immediately when he states that he does not qualify as one. In Toussaint's tragedy, we can neither witness an insoluble conflict of the human condition, nor a manifestation of fate in the sense of the Greek tragedy, the dike, which rules over a world neither we nor the gods have made. In James' materialist outlook, the historical circumstances and characters replace fate. The dramatic embodiment of fate in Toussaint's case is the figure of Napoleon, who throughout the text forms Toussaint's negative alter ego on the historical stage. It is him who orders the invasion of Saint-Domingue by a massive expeditionary force with the aim to restore slavery. This plunges Toussaint into the following tragic conflict: to stay loyal to France that gave him the principle of liberty, as he was convinced that Saint-Domingue would decay without the benefits of the French connection? Or should he fight France, as under Napoleon it has begun to betray its revolutionary heritage and anti-slavery stance? For Toussaint was convinced that slavery could never be restored. Toussaint is unable to resolve this contradiction, this conflict. He becomes paralyzed and is eventually captured by the French. His loyalty to the French Revolution that made him, that we heard that this morning as well, now unmakes him. Him clinging on to the values of the Enlightenment links his tragic failure to the wider failure of the Enlightenment, the failure to live up to its promise of universal liberation. While Toussaint falls, the masses save the day. The masses save the day. Showing greater political understanding than their leaders, they fight through the conflict through its anti-tragic, ultimate, and irresistible resolution. Without offering any proof, James claims that Toussaint's certainty of this anti-tragic resolution explains his mistakes and atones for him, his tragic blunders. Widely, unexpectedly, the masses drive out the French and achieve independence. And again, this is cast in metaphors of drama. The furthest imagination could not have envisaged the entry of the chorus, these are the masses, of the ex-slaves themselves as the arbiters of their own fate. Unlike in Greek tragedy, in which the chorus does not significantly influence the action of the drama, the actions of James' chorus are decisive for the anti-tragic resolution to the drama of the Haitian Revolution. Okay, coming to my last point, which is now I'm coming to proletarian tragedy in Black Jacobins. However, just focusing on this anti-tragic resolution or on Toussaint's tragedy risked missing the underlying, simultaneously unfolding proletarian tragedy. If not as explicitly as the interaction of the revolutionary genres in the Brumaire, Toussaint's tragedy also interacts with a proletarian tragedy. The conflict between him and the message, which marks the turning point in Toussaint's drama, was sparked off by the following events. Toussaint's 1808 constitution made him governor for life, endowed him with dictatorial powers, and tied the ex-slaves to the plantation. To boost the economy, Toussaint gave some of the plantations to the returning whites and forced, under the threat of severe punishment, the ex-slaves to continue laboring on the plantations. This led to a laborers' revolt in which some 100 whites were killed. Toussaint brutally cracked down on it, executing several hundreds of his leaders and his adopted nephew, General Moïse, whom Toussaint suspected of involvement. In the 1967 play, Moïse is even very explicit as cast as a social revolutionary, because he demands to break up these accursed big plantation and to redistribute the land. Sorry. Okay, so we have this conflict between Toussaint and the masses developing. James is aware that in this instance, race and class conflict intricately merged. He claims that deep down, the ex-slaves hated their former masters who had returned to the plantations not so much for their racial status as whites, but rather for their class, the socioeconomic supremacy and their privilege. As he states, the dialectic interaction between race and class in a very Marxist sense. Here we still have, this is an image where we can see the black and white Jacobins, so to speak, merging before. But here, I'm coming now to this quotation which we also heard this morning, and it's kind of overlapping. The race question is subsidiary to the class question in politics, and to think of imperialism in terms of race is disastrous. But to neglect the racial factor as merely incidental is an error only less grave than to make it fundamental. In spite of this passage, which seems, at least to me, ultimately stipulate the primacy of class over race as the primary determining factor, James strenuously denies that any class conflict existed between Toussaint and the laborers. There was no fundamental difference or outlook between him and the masses. and Toussaint only employed the wrong method, but not principle. The wrong method was to keep the reasons for his action to himself, as Kara M. Rabbit sums up in Aristotelian poetic terms. Toussaint's error of judgment, his harmatia, consisted in not explaining to the black masses the rationale of his actions. And now it comes to comparison from Trotsky's History of the Revolution, which we also heard about today. Unlike Lenin and his fellow Bolshevists, Toussaint explained nothing. So that was his fatal error of judgment. James stresses that for Toussaint to alienate the black masses and execute the champion of their rights was his fatal mistake, even a crime. It would almost be as if Lenin had Trotsky shot for taking the side of the proletariat against the bourgeoisie. Despite this comparison, which places Maurice on the side of the proto-proletarian masses and Toussaint on the side of the Creole bourgeoisie, in Black Jacobins, there's no acknowledgement of this or any other class conflict between Toussaint and the masses. For instance, between the new black elite on the one hand, many of whom, including Toussaint and Dessalines, owned plantations themselves, and the cultivators on the other, who were forced to continue working on the plantations in conditions that resembled slavery. The closest James comes to acknowledging such a class conflict between Toussaint and the masses is in the following passage. Every observer, and Toussaint himself, thought that the laborers were following because of his past services and unquestioned superiority. The insurrection proved that they were following him because he represented the complete emancipation from their former degradation, which was their chief goal. As soon as they saw that he was not following, no longer going to this end, they were ready to throw him over. Similar to the Brumaire, proletarian social revolutionary action revealed the delusions of the leaders and the underlying class conflict that has remained hidden. In contrast to James, I would argue that this conflict over complete emancipation is a class conflict. While the ex-slave achieved what James calls bare freedom, upholding the abolition of slavery in the War of Independence, the goal of complete emancipation remains beyond their reach. This includes the abolition of plantation work and complete socio-economic freedom. At the end of the Haitian Revolution, the masses still largely remain cultivators on the plantations, if they were not part of the army, that is. With their leadership insisting on the supremacy of the sugar plantation, the workers are still far from enjoying the fruits of the earth as they hoped in their appropriation of the rights of men at the beginning of the Haitian Revolution. Comparably to the Parisian workers who had also endowed the phrases of the French Revolution with a new social content, the Haitian revolutionaries remain tragic heroes as their aim of complete emancipation has not been reached. It's only in the appendix in which James outlines his poetics of future anti-colonial revolution that a vision is offered how this tragic element is to be overcome. To overthrow the colonial property structure, to leave the plantation economy behind, requires no longer any revolutionary leaders such as Toussaint, but rather the revolutionary mass of the people to lead themselves. I would argue that James has become disillusioned with revolutionary leaders increasingly in 1963, which is also visible in his Nkrumah book and all the failed, more or less failed anti-colonial revolutions in Africa testify to it. So he goes to the masses now as leaders. To realize themselves, they have to break out of the shackles of the colonial system. James insists, as he emphasizes that the masses themselves have to reverse their alienation dating back to slavery. One lever for this is the creative power of the great masses of the people, as he writes in Dialectical Materialism. Of this, the popular culture of the Caribbean constitutes a prime example. in dance, in the innovation of musical instruments and popular singing unrivaled anywhere in the world. Like the proletarian revolution of the 19th century in the Brumaire, this popular Marxist anti-colonial revolution of the 20th century cannot, I'm quoting from the Brumaire now, draw its poesy from the past, but only from the future. A revolutionary poesy, James finds, for instance, expressed in Aimé Césaire's anti-colonial epic poem of Nekitude, Cahier de un retour à un pays natal, with its insistence on the revolutionary transatlantic revolutionary culture and history of the black people. Thank you.
Thanks, Raphael. We're going to go straight on to Joanna and then take questions at the end.
First of all, I would like to say that I am very pleased and I feel very honored to be among the participants of this conference. Let me just begin from a fact which is in some way related to my country, Poland. There is in Haitian Vodun religion, which is very often called voodoo, there is a goddess, the goddess of love, Erzulie. And Erzulie is very often depicted in a way which for every Polish person will be strikingly similar to the best known image of the Virgin Mary in Poland. So there is a striking similarity between those two images. And for everyone who has read the Black Jacobins very attentively, it will be obvious from where this influence comes. There were some Polish soldiers who, during the Leclerc expedition, joined the Haitian troops, joined the troops who were fighting against those who tried to reestablish slavery. So I would like to begin this paper by mentioning a truly striking fact. The Black Jacobins, as a study of Haitian revolution, have completely overshadowed a study written by another seminal black author mentioned by Raphael, Aimé Césaire, one of the founders of the Negritude movement. His lengthy book, Toussaint Louverture, The French Revolution and the Colonial Problem, first published in 1962, has never even been released in an English translation and is undeniably the last known amongst Césaire's works. This becomes all the more thought-provoking, considering the crucial importance he attached to the Haitian upheaval. So in his notebook of a return to the native land, also mentioned by Raphael, Césaire refers to Haiti, where negritude rose for the first time and stated that it believed in its humanity, and poignantly and vividly depicts Toussaint's imprisonments and heroism in face of white screams of white death. Not less importantly, Césaire's play The Tragedy of King Christophe, another one of his best known and admired works, focuses on the dilemmas facing post-revolutionary Haiti and on the figure of one of the main revolutionary leaders, Christophe, which also those who have read the Black Jacobins very attentively know that C.L.R. James did not have a very good opinion of Christophe. He once describes him as a poor fool. So the opinion of Césaire was completely different. So let us return to the much less known book Césaire devoted to Haiti, to Toussaint Louverture, and let us first emphasize that James dismissed Césaire's book as a disappointing, though extremely competent, biography that, as he put it, lacks the fire and constant illumination which distinguish most of the other work of Césaire. So it is quite interesting that C.L.R. James was so dismissive of this book and even mistakenly described it as a biography. It is equally interesting to note that Césaire mentions the Black Jacobins only in one footnote in his own study. So they just did not appreciate each other's studies so much. So one may be, however, tempted to say that the two works complement each other. And the approach both Césaire and James adopt in these books may easily obscure some issues which were of crucial importance to both these authors and which I am going to discuss in this paper. So, as Raphael earlier said, James in Black Jacobins largely embraces a perspective influenced by Marx. Césaire in his Toussaint Louverture embraces such a perspective to an even greater extent. So Césaire was very strongly influenced by the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. An inattentive reader may even risk the conclusion that both James and Césaire viewed the Haitian Revolution mainly through the prism of a European-derived theoretical approach as basically a class revolution with the added complication of racial strife, that they applied the Marxian frame of analysis to the context of a society based on racial plantation slave. But on a closer reading of both texts, and especially if one reads them alongside James's play Toussaint Louverture, the story of the only successful slave revolt in history, this play has just been published this year, and Césaire's, in the context of Césaire's already mentioned play, The Tragedy of King Christophe, it becomes clear that both authors viewed issues of culture as crucial aspects of the Haitian Revolution. In The Black Jacobins, the cultural dilemma faced by the revolutionaries becomes the source of Toussaint's tragedy, and one is even tempted to say the tragic dimension of the Haitian Revolution. As to the tragedy of Christophe and of Haiti in Césaire's play, it largely derives from the same cultural dilemma. And there is a certain thought-provoking fact inextricably linked to the subject of this paper, which has not yet received as much attention as it deserves. So in The Black Jacobins, James uses words that indicate that even he, a radical, anti-imperialist, and pan-African intellectual, was not immune to the influence of the Western concepts of civilization and savagery. He once describes the slaves of San Domingo as half-savage, and importantly, contrasts them with the advanced workers of revolutionary Paris. In another passage, he uses the following words to emphasize that the mulattoes were much better educated than the blacks. With their education, not so widespread as among the whites, but immensely superior to the half-white blacks. So one can conclude that when James was working on The Black Jacobins, education in the Western sense was to him the way out of a state of half-whiteness or half-savagery. So in consequence, when, in order to depict the plight of Toussaint, James writes, it is probable that looking at the wild hordes of blacks who surrounded him, his heart sank at the prospect of the war and the barbarism which would follow freedom even if it were achieved. It is difficult to resist the thought that this passage reflects not only Toussaint's perspective, but also to a certain extent the way James perceived the Haitian masses at the time when he was working on The Black Jacobins. But it would be completely mistaken to neglect the difference between the perspective of James and the perspective of Toussaint. So the French general Pomphile de la Croix, whose memoirs were one of the sources used by James when he was writing The Black Jacobins, claims that Toussaint often said, I don't want to be taken for a Negro from the coast. Je n'ai pas envie de passer pour un nègre de la côte. So the coast was, of course, the West African coast. Whether Pomphile de la Croix was telling the truth or not, James' portrayal of Toussaint's attitude towards the San Domingo black masses, who were African in their majority, Moreau de Saint-Marie, says that two-thirds of the San Domingo slaves were born in Africa in his description of the French part of San Domingo published in 1797. So this portrayal of Toussaint in James's book seems quite convincing. The Toussaint was convinced that Africans were savages. So in his play Toussaint Louverture, James makes another very important Haitian leader, Dessalines, openly attack Toussaint's belief in the importance of Western education and religion. When Toussaint, convinced that San Domingo needs France, stresses that the people need education and that the few Christians among the former slaves follow the French religion, Catholicism, Dessalines replies as if tired of Toussaint's way of thinking. Education, religion, Toussaint, always the white man's religion, the white man's education. To Dessalines, the white man's cruelties are infinitely more important and reflect the deep hypocrisy of white civilization. As he bluntly tells Toussaint, white planters, men with your white religion, left the ineffaceable marks of the whip on the bodies of the former slaves. And the play leaves no doubt that Dessalines is right to sell too trusting towards whites, unaware of the extent of their hypocrisy and ruthlessness, falls into a diabolical trap they had laid for him. So the dialogue between the two black leaders in James's play poignantly conveys the way he viewed Toussaint's dilemma. Toussaint was very strongly influenced by French culture, convinced that Africans are merely barbarous savages. These are the words Toussaint uses in James's play, and that in consequence, Saint Domingo should remain close to France. Moreover, Toussaint was never as directly affected by the cruelty of the slavery system as the vast majority of slaves. James writes in Black Jacobins that Toussaint has probably never been whipped. And in James's play, Dessalines stresses that Toussaint does not carry marks of the whip on his body. So Toussaint was ready and willing to trust whites. He simply did not realize that very many whites were not even ready to fully recognize the humanity of black people. He did not understand that black people's efforts to become civilized in the Western sense, to build a society which would be deemed civilized by whites, were doomed to failure, simply because so many whites refused to recognize black people as equal human beings. There is an engraving from the period of French Revolution by a certain Louis Darcy, and this engraving speaks volumes. It depicts a black man in a Phrygian cap, and it is accompanied by a few words in broken French, moi libre aussi, me free too, as if the abolition of slavery in French colonies were a generous gift of the Republic to the enslaved and uncivilized blacks. Nothing about the heroic struggle of the San Domingo people. But the engraving, though so condescending and hypocritical, recognizes the human rights of black people. Aimé Césaire gives in his book on the Haitian Revolution an excellent portrayal of the state of mind of those who, to borrow the words of Dessalines from James's play, saw blacks as fit only to be slaves. Césaire quotes the words of a document on the motives for the reestablishment of slavery, written by a certain Dupuis, who was among those who presented the project of the so-called Law of 30 Floreal Year 10, which maintained slavery in the colonies returned to France by Britain. The document mentions the illusions of freedom and equality propagated in these remote countries and emphasizes the remarkable difference between the civilized and the uncivilized men, a difference portrayed as insurmountable and inextricably tied to skin color. But Bonaparte expressed the same ideas in a very blunt way, very direct way, a way which allows us to call him simply a white supremacist, an unashamed white supremacist, because Dupuis was a somewhat less direct one. So in response to the words of Truguet, one of the members of his Council of State, Bonaparte reveals his racist views without any inhibitions and in crude words. Mr. Truguet, if you had come to Egypt to preach us the freedom of blacks or Arabs, we would have hung you on the top of a mast. All the whites have been abandoned to the ferocity of blacks, and you don't even allow the victims to complain. Well, if I had been in Martinique, I would have begged the English, because one must first of all save one's life. I am on the side of whites because I am white. I have no other reason, and this one is a good one. How could they give freedom to Africans, to people who had no civilization at all, who did not even know what a colony was, what France was? It is obvious that those who wanted the freedom of blacks want the enslavement of whites. So this is what Napoleon thinks, this great Napoleon so often celebrated in school books on history. He was a white supremacist, yes. To someone like Napoleon, black people were therefore not only wholly deprived of civilization and completely undeserving of freedom, but also ferocious beasts bent on exterminating whites. He pronounces the word Africans with the utmost contempt. Africans are only ignorant savages in his eyes. From the perspective of Napoleon and others who shared his views, black people could never even hope to be recognized as fully human, not to even speak of being recognized as civilized. From this perspective, one fully sees how futile and tragic was Toussaint's dream about a black island civilized in the European sense. In his play, The Tragedy of King Christophe, Césaire seems to suggest that many black people in Haiti were cherishing this impossible dream, convinced that if only the formerly enslaved people adopted a way of life deemed civilized by the Europeans, they would be recognized and respected as their equals. In one of the scenes of the play, an old man speaks with delight of the crowds assembled in the royal palace. He is an old black man, of course. "Look, look, what a beautiful assembly. Nothing delights me more than seeing our blacks in silk coats and with forests of feathers on their heads, blue, red, white." And it is obvious that he views this courtly attire as a vivid proof that the black people are not in any way inferior to whites. More and more agitated, he calls out to the invisible races, as if constantly painfully aware of the hostile gaze they cast on black people. "Come, you detractors of our species, of our ways and our nature, and now tell us that we are not worthy of freedom." The old man addresses himself also to those whites who recognize the humanity of black people, but who condescendingly view them as need of being civilized in the European sense of following the example of their supposedly much more advanced white brothers. He says, "And you, philanthropists of all nations, you who are strangers to prejudice, who recognize in us the work of the same creator, rejoice in seeing the objects of your predilection respond so fully to your benevolent wishes." In the eyes of the old man, the fact that the Haitian black elites have embraced the European vision of the civilized way of life proves, therefore, that the people of Haiti have the unquestionable right to be treated as the equals of whites, both by those who earlier viewed black people as less than human and by those who perceived them as the not yet civilized younger brethren of whites. So for a large part of the play, Césaire's Christophe, the King Christophe, himself seems to share, at least to a certain extent, the belief of the old man. In a scene in the first act, Christophe makes it clear that he believes that the Haitian people should be lifted to civilization and claims that he has done more than anyone else to achieve this goal. In an earlier, exquisitely grotesque scene in the first act, a white master of ceremony, Césaire explains in a mocking footnote that he's a delegate from TESCO, no pun intended, Technical Educational Scientific Cooperation Organization, and thus makes it clear that the tragedy of King Christophe is about more than the dilemmas facing Haiti in the aftermath of the revolution. So this white master of ceremony in Césaire's play instructs the courtiers how to move and behave during the coronation ceremony. Vaste, Christophe's secretary, exclaims that this court is a perfect replica in black of the best accomplishments of old Europe in matters of court. Crucially, Césaire's Christophe is convinced that he has to be as harsh and pitiless towards his people as a schoolmaster brandishing the ferule, because black people were totally dehumanized by the experience of enslavement, the collective degradation to the level of the animal. This is why Christophe finds it necessary to civilize his people, because of this all-denying speech, the utter debasement caused by enslavement. His views on black people are clearly different from the ones of James Toussaint, who perceived Africans as savages compared to Europeans. Nevertheless, it cannot be denied that for a large part of the play, Christophe remains strongly influenced by European ideas on what constitutes civilized behavior. An eloquent example is offered by the scene where he decides to force some peasants to marriage. He says to them, "I don't want my subjects to run around like this, with an open fly, like savages. So I have decided that you will get married straight away." So both Césaire's, Christophe, and James Toussaint, the latter, of course, to a much greater extent, have internalized the European vision of civilization. Both of them, just like the old man from Césaire's play, and just like another character from the same play, Vaste, remain acutely aware of the white gaze, le regard blanc, to borrow the words of Franz Fanon. Vaste emphasizes that the whole world is looking at the Haitian people and that the nations think that black people lack dignity. Fanon hauntingly describes the experience of constantly enduring the looks of people who viewed him as inferior because of his skin color.
An unfamiliar weight burdened me. I made up my mind to laugh myself to tears, but laughter had become impossible. I progress by crawling. And already I am being dissected under white eyes, the only real eyes. I am fixed. I am laid bare. I feel, I see in those white faces that it is not a new man who has come in, but a new kind of man, a new genus. Why, it's a Negro. Another great black thinker, Du Bois, uses the term double consciousness while speaking of the phenomenon of the internalization of the white gaze. In his famous and seminal work, The Souls of Black Folk, he describes double consciousness as the sense of always looking at oneself through the eyes of others, of measuring one's soul by the tape of a world that looks on in amused contempt and pity. According to Pomphile de la Croix, this already mentioned French author, Toussaint often encouraged his officers to imitate the manners of whites, saying, "Try to adopt these manners and learn how to introduce yourself in the right way. This is what it means to have been brought up in France. My children will be like this." If the words of Lacroix are to be believed, one may conclude that Toussaint hoped that the white world would look at his sons with respect, thanks to their French education, that would turn them into perfectly civilized men. We already know that in the eyes of such people as Napoleon, blacks would always remain subhuman and fit only to be slaves, no matter how hard they tried to be deemed civilized by whites. Let me quote the words of a Nigerian scholar in black literature and culture, Femi Ojoade, who in his book, Aimé Césaire's African Theatre of Poets, Prophets and Politicians, writes in this way: "The other refuses to fully accept the black into the paradise of civilization, no matter how hard he strives and how well he succeeds in the mission of civilization." However, neither James nor Césaire portray Haitian revolutionaries as doomed to futile efforts to be recognized as civilized and therefore as equals by the white world. As already mentioned, Dessalines in James's play has a very negative view of white culture, and he is the one who proves to be more perspicacious and realistic than Toussaint. In the last scene of the play, Dessalines calls the people to arms against the enemy, changes the island's name to Haiti. In his words, the old name the island had before these Europeans came to bring slavery and degradation, and tramples the white of a French flag. Yet even though James stresses the conflict between the views of Dessalines and Toussaint on white culture, unlike Césaire, he devotes little attention to the place of Africanity in the imaginary and praxis of those and other black revolutionaries, and generally during the Haitian Revolution and its aftermath. So when it comes, because James mentions the voodoo ceremony in Bois Caimont, he mentions the voodoo chant Kanga Bafiote and claims that this was the favorite song of slaves during voodoo ceremonies, but unlike Césaire, he does not say that this was a chant invoking African gods. So the fact that Césaire speaks of the African roots of the chant Kanga Bafiote is much more significant than it may seem, because for Césaire, Africanity was of central, crucial importance. The connection between Africa and the African diaspora was of crucial importance. And so his hero, Christophe, is undeniably torn apart between Africanity and this European-derived civilization. And in the final act, the suppressed voices of the African-derived religion, voodoo, return with a vengeance to haunt the king. Here I am to some extent indebted to an eminent scholar, African-Caribbean like Césaire, like James Fanon, Frederick Ivor Case, who wrote an article in 1975, Shango Obakoso, Le Vaudoun dans la tragédie du roi Christophe. So this return of the suppressed African voices finds a striking expression in the scene which takes place at the church in Limonade during the Catholic Feast of Assumption. Christophe, as if unable to control himself, repeatedly interrupts the prayers in Latin and invokes the Vodun gods, Herzulie Freda Dahomey, Loco, Petro, Brise Pimba, and others. His remark on the goddess Zeid Bader Kodnozom makes it clear that according to Césaire, Haitian revolutionaries very often found their support in the gods of the African religion and not in the Christian God. Christophe says that the goddess Zaid Bader Kodonozom pointed the cannons of the freedom fighters. And when the king falls down paralyzed at the end of this scene, he asks, who has put on me the Bakulu Baka scars? Bakulu Baka is a malevolent god of the petrol cult in the Haiti Vodun religion. And in the final scenes of the play, Christophe, once so determined to rule Haitians with an iron hand in order to elevate them to civilization, fully and lyrically embraces his Africanity, as if he had finally realized that it was the deepest and most real part of his being, and that it was far more meaningful to celebrate this Africanity of himself and of the whole Haitian people than to desperately try to gain the recognition and respect of the white world, even if it meant stifling one's humanity and violating the humanity of others. Because in a scene in an early act, Act Two, Christophe orders his soldiers to kill a sleeping peasant only because the peasant is sleeping at a time when he should be working. But now the king, profoundly changed, invokes the gods of Africa and calls Africa his place of powers. And just before committing suicide, he calls out to Africa that he undeniably views as a motherly figure. Africa, help me to return. Carry me in your arms like an old child. And then you will undress me. You will wash me. Get me rid of all these clothes. Get me rid of them as when, at dawn, one gets rid of the night dreams. Get me rid of my nobles, of my nobility, of my scepter, of my crown. And wash me. Oh, wash off their powder, their kisses, my kingdom. As to the rest, I will take care of it myself. And before the king's death, his buffoon, Hugonin, enters wearing the attire of Baron Samedi, the very popular Haitian god of death, who is traditionally portrayed in a long black coat, a black top hat, and sunglasses, and who is also associated with crossroads. Hugonin, constantly cynical and lewd since the beginning of the play, makes one think of the behavior of those believed to be possessed by Baron Samedi. And though seemingly only a ridiculous buffoon, he is strikingly perspicacious and frank, just like Baron Samedi. Hugonin is also singing in this scene in Haitian Creole of another god, the Yoruba god Ogun Badagry. Ogun is one of the most important Yoruba gods, the god of hunting, war, iron, laughter, and revenge. So Hugonin sings, Ogun Badagry se neg politique o. Ume ale ume tourne, Ogun Badagry se la liye. And it means, Ogun Badagry, he's a political Negro. Wherever he goes, Ogun Badagry is following him. So what he means is that Christophe, the King Christophe, was always followed by this Yoruba god. So as we can see, Césaire emphasizes the inextricable links between the Haitian Vodun religion and the African Yoruba religion. And these links become even more obvious in the final scene of the play, where one of the African pages of King Christophe is saying to the dead king, Father, we are installing you in Ife, on the hill of the three palm trees. Father, we are installing you in Ife, in 16 rhombs of the wind. So in the Yoruba religion, the city Ife is regarded as the cradle of humanity. And the rhombs of the wind, the 16 rhombs of the wind, can be interpreted, as Femi Ojoade, the Nigerian scholar, suggests, can be interpreted as the 16 cowries used in Yoruba divination by the priest who blows on them before starting the divination. As to palm oil and palm nuts, they also play an essential role in Yoruba religion, for example, the palm oil in sacrifices. And also, the African page addresses the dead king as Shango, the Yoruba god of fire, lightning, and thunder. Shango was himself a king, the ruler of the city of Oyo, who hanged himself, but was revived as a god and orisha by his wife Oya. So Shango committed suicide and Christophe commits suicide. The similarity is obvious. And those who are closest to the Haitian king in Césaire's play are fully aware that Christophe reconciled himself with his African roots before his death, that he no longer wanted to be like every white king, to borrow the words of the presenter commentator in the prologue to Césaire's play. And Christophe's suicide may be interpreted as a ritual act, as a kind of symbolic return to Africa. He repeats the gesture of King Shango. And what about civilization? This is already the last part, which will be very short. When Hugonet finally reveals the close ties between himself and the Haitian god Baron Samedi, he talks, among others, of the white master of ceremony. This dancing master, incarnating the outraged civilization, proclaims to all the winds of history that there is no hope for the Negroes. Il n'y a rien à faire avec le nègre. So all the efforts to become civilized enough to be recognized as fully human by the West were futile. But the final act of Cesaire's play, as well as the final scene of James's play, prove that it is possible to free oneself from the prison of the white gaze. And as Cesaire suggests in his play, the reconciliation with one's Africanity and the celebration of Africanity may be a way to this true spiritual liberation. So on a final note, and this is really the end, one is tempted to conclude that the dilemmas facing the Haitian leaders in Cesaire's and James's works are to some extent the same as the dilemmas facing black people even today. In some countries, like my country, Poland, many still openly use the term civilized countries and to make it clear that they do not think of the African countries or Haiti. Elsewhere, the language is different, but the racist vision of civilization continues to permeate many minds. But to James, Cesaire, Fanon, Du Bois, and many others, it was clear that black people were not doomed to strive to prove that they were civilized enough to be recognized as equals, that another way was possible. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, well, two very rich papers that both that read James productively in relationship to other texts, I think. Questions?
It's a caricature by a radical engraver, 1792, and this device of the split figure was very common at that time. And on the one hand, you can see a quite lusty, ruddy sans-culotte with a stagger dripping full of blood. And on the right-hand side, you see this sort of Africanized, the diabolical figure, and he's even wearing a fetish around his neck, if you look closely. And this sort of devil serpent tail is going through the Atlantic and emerging in England. So we have what this image in my reading, this image evokes this double fear of, on the one hand, the French Revolution, the sans-culottes from there, and on the other hand, the Saint-Domingue rebels. It's also a real sans-culotte. I think it's a pun, Saint-Domingue. In some ways, they're equal, sort of black, one the white, black Jacobins, but of course, he's the figure of the black Jacobins is much more diabolical still. So that's I think it's a very much a warning of the potential danger that this revolt, when it was 1792, quite early, would present to Britain. But again, I sort of this equation of this, the black and white Jacobins, but not in the positive sense as James does it, but in this more diabolical, demonizing.
It's a little bit outside of what you were talking about, so
yeah.
Apologies for that.
See if you can answer for it.
It's basically about what Marx says about Saluk and the 18th Brumaire. What you did was you took two texts and you took Marx and used it to read James.
Mm-hmm.
I wondered if you could also sort of what Haiti at that time, around the end of the 1840s, mm-hmm. If you could look at that history and say what it says about Marx, or...
You mean the later history of, in the 19th century?
Yeah, so what was going on in Haiti when Marx was writing the 18th Brumaire, and what...
Yeah,
if you could use any of that, and what Marx says about Salute.
He's very... I mean, the only reference really from Haiti, that's what you are referring to so long to the emperor, and he sort of says it's quite racist actually in the way that it's another farcical parody. Was he first crowned first, or was little Napoleon?
So Luke was crowned
first, yeah.
And then Napoleon, and
exactly.
So had another crown in 20 minutes.
Oh yeah, exactly. So you got this again, this mimicking. It's like a repetition where it's mimicking, and he's very much, he's comparing the whole courtiers and his whole state as this, in a quite racist way, as this absolutely ridiculous state of again tying to this idea of not being really civilized. They're imitating the French, and so it's in my reading I sort of, an essay which I want to publish, I mentioned it very briefly and just say that it's not really working for his, I mean, it is working as the poetics because it's kind of repetition again. One is repetition, parodying the other, so this parody framework. But it's not, I think it's very much this, yeah, I can pick it up as a point that so with Marx and race, not only sort of a blind spot, but kind of an openly racist perspective there. So let's say that.
In terms of the way that we discuss equal rights and equality today, and it's primarily through the prism of human rights, and I'm kind of worried that current day way of thinking about rights pervades the way that we now talk about rights past. And actually, my view of James was what he was very, very solid and insistent about was that rights are things that historically come to those who demand them. So equality is something that you fight for and struggle for, and it's not something that you ask to be conferred or ask for. Mm-hmm. Equality is not really a privilege, it's something that as historically, you say, we are equal by the sheer force of our will to be equal. And in some sense, that sums up the Haitian Revolution, which was the basis on which the Black Jacobins and the play were written. So I struggle, and that really comes down to a universalist notion of human equality, which is that we all have the capacity as humans, no matter how brutalized, how oppressed, we all have the capacity for self-emancipation. Do you think it's a problem now the way that rights are discussed today in terms of human rights, which is that there is this abstract notion, and also that by virtue of this abstract notion of human rights that we should have our rights recognized, we are losing the capacity, the real essence of rights, which is that we as individuals and as collectives can actually strive to become equals.
The abstract issue of human rights is something else. And something else is the fact that when it comes to the perspective of either Césaire or James or Du Bois or Fanon or the today's radical black intellectuals, they are convinced that the problem is to some extent the same as in the times when James was working on the Black Jacobins, that black people, especially in Africa, are not recognized as fully human, that it is the problem. They are not recognized as fully human by the white world. And of course, this may sound very shocking if one says something like this. But even as I say, even in this expression used openly in some countries as my country, the civilized countries, the civilized world, they never include the African countries, or Haiti, or Jamaica, or other, let us say, parts of the world where people are mostly of African descent. I think that the human rights, of course, James was convinced that people have to fight for their rights. But he also saw it very clearly, especially in his play, Toussaint Louverture, that Toussaint, despite being such an eminent, remarkable figure, was convinced that he would be recognized as an equal if he is civilized in the French way. And the historical Toussaint was the same. If we might, of course, Pomfil de la Croix may not be, he may have been lying or distorting facts, but I think that James trusted Pomfil de la Croix's account of the Haitian Revolution to some extent. So I think that really Toussaint was simply, Toussaint, he was a sincere Catholic. He was very influenced by the French culture. Toussaint really probably believed that these Africans, he was himself not an African, but the son of an African, that these Africans are not civilized, that they should be civilized in order to be recognized as equals. So this problem remains until today for black people everywhere. This problem of not being recognized as, of being viewed as inferior, of being recognized as not like whites. Even I was a bit surprised, maybe I misunderstood some of the people who were talking during the plenary session, but one of the people, I don't know, one of the professors, I would not like to be disrespectful, he said that primitive black, that these Jacobins were primitive black, and he associated in some way primitivity and blackness. I did not like it. So this was in some way, and the same person emphasized that, that the voodoo was used in the Haitian Revolution as something which seemed primitive in some way to him. And so this is a way of looking which is predominant until today, even among people who are specialists in C.L.R. James. This way of thinking which assumes that there is civilization and there is primitive, uncivilized culture. So I don't know if I helped in some way if I answered you in a satisfying way, but I tried.
There's a tension between, like I said to Robertson, Black Marxism, mm-hmm. and his chapter on C.L.R. James, he refers to C.L.R. James as a Victorian intellectual for a reason, for a clear reason, in terms of kind of showing C.L.R. James's educational, intellectual upbringing, background, which was steeped in this English literature, quite Anglophone culture, even though he's living in Trinidad, but his initial points of reference were something like English literature, William Thackeray, and so on and so forth. So, Robertson refers to the black Victorian intellectual coming to the metropole. And then at the same time, we've got something like Francophone, we've got Negritude, we've got the whole Renaissance, we've got Marcus Garvey. So, you've got, you know, that going on. But in terms of, it's interesting to see over the years of C.L.R. James' political and cultural kind of Korean writings, how he orientates at different times to what's happening sort of like, you know, in Europe and in the Caribbean and in the diaspora and in the African diaspora. And so there are sort of different times where the Africanity, the African consciousness comes more to the fore, and there are other times when that African consciousness is sort of like more in the background. And so I think it's partly sort of like, you know, getting a sense of that, you know, and in comparison to somebody like Emma Cézanne. But I suspect that Emma Cézanne, being one of the originators of Negritude, had a very, in terms of his background and upbringing, a very different political and philosophical feeling to in relation, compared to and contrast to C.L.R. James. So I think that's, you know,
yes, it's very, very interesting.
The source of the tension. Mm-hmm. And then it plays out even, because there are different streams in terms of like the African diaspora and readings of history. So the different streams in terms of like the interpretation of the Haitian Revolution. So you can have very Afrocentric reading of the Haitian Revolution. So scholars who came to the UK, Malala Karenga, was one of the scholars that gave the inaugural address on Black History Month in London. And Malala Karenga has quite a different reading in terms of the Haitian Revolution to that of C.L.R. James. And John Henry Clark, who's another historian, again, that spoke during 1997, during the inauguration of Black History Month. And if you read transcripts of the talks, John Henry Clark in particular, very scathing of C.L.R. James in terms of C.L.R. James's descriptions of aspects of the Asian Revolution. And so there, what I'm trying to say is that they're sort of, and so they're quite Afrocentric. They're very Afrocentric scholars. So they're different streams in terms of an Africanism, in terms of interpretations of survivals of African culture and Africanity throughout the diaspora. And these different streams also have different interpretations of the Asian Revolution.
Thank you very much. It really brought me a lot. Yeah. Thank you.
I think it's probably time to wrap up and head up for lunch now. But thanks again to the panelists, but
thank
also
you.
For some great questions as well. Thank you.